The Other Day, Current Era, 1979. Translation and voiceover by BMI Russian. Good evening. Welcome to episode 19 of our series, The Other Day, 1961 to 1991, Current Era. Events, people, and occurrences which define a lifestyle. Things we can't imagine ourselves without, let alone comprehend. Another year, another episode. This one is about 1979. Overthrowing Pol Pot, Sparrow at the North Pole, Khamenei's Islamic Revolution, karate, Thatcher wins the election, the Yatran typewriter, the woman who sings, the Paktakor crash, the historical novelists Akujav and Pikul sending troops to Afghanistan, D'Artagnan played by Boyarsky. Commenting we have actress Tatiana Drubich, economic expert Igor Gaidar, political expert Sergei Karaganov. In 1979, the title Merited Artist of the RSFSR is granted to Valentina Tolkunova. She was a sort of Vasilisa the Beautiful to Russian arts, with her full-length dress, waist-long braided hair, and delicate voice. The repertoire of the USSR's most modest star included national hit songs with a folklore flavor. Talk to Me Mother, Silver Weddings, We Were Riding a Boat, Snub Noses, I Can't Do It Any Other Way. Tolkunova's heroine wasn't after independence. She wasn't trying to make a career. Her being a true Soviet woman, she took responsibility for her love and children. The socialist Laos was oriented towards Vietnam, while the socialist Kampuchea leaned towards China. Vietnam's struggle for influence in the region first led to armed conflict and then to all-out military action. Vietnamese troops swiftly went through Kampuchean territory to claim the capital city of Phnom Penh. And in 1979, the entire world learned what the reign of Pol Pot's government was all about. During his 4 years in power, Pol Pot massacred millions of people. Modern history knows no other examples of a regime committing such genocide against its own nation. Red Khmer squads, which carried out punishment operations, left behind piles of human skulls and villages burned down together with their inhabitants. Whoever survived became feral. City dwellers were sent into the jungles, all schools were shut down, money was abolished as a bourgeois anachronism, temples were destroyed. The Soviet people had a saying, here's a mild representation. I'm gonna torture you dead like Pol Pot's Kampuchean bloodshed. Vietnam appointed their ally Heng Samrin as head of Kampuchea, and the country was in no hurry to withdraw its troops. Such a turn of events made China furious, though it's not like the two countries were on good terms before that. This sparked conflicts on the border between Vietnam and China. On February 17, 1979, Chinese troops crossed the border and were en route deep into Vietnam in five directions. Some wise guys called this Socialist War I. The USSR didn't take well to Chinese aggression. As soon as news about the attack broke out, a demonstration spontaneously took place next to the Chinese embassy in Moscow, with people even throwing stones over the fence. The militia rushed to surround the entire district. Meanwhile, rumors were circulating in the army that we would exploit the situation and help Vietnam defeat China in a war on two fronts. But in the meantime, on the distant tropic front, it turned out that the Vietnamese, who had grown used to constant battle, were much more efficient. The Chinese army was suffering tremendous losses and hastily retreated. And in just 2 months, in April, they sat down to negotiate their way out of the situation. Soviet strategists saw that China's gigantic army wasn't prepared for modern warfare, which gave them the opportunity to fully concentrate on enemy number one from across the ocean. Vietnamese workers are invited to Soviet factories. They were designated yellow and given dirty black jobs. Over 20 years had passed since the Youth and Student Festival, and the Soviet Union had long become a very racist country. The official reason for Vietnamese presence in our factories was internship. Considering the unemployment rate back home, for Vietnamese workers coming to the USSR meant no more hunger and support for their families. Soviet industry received a reliable source of manpower. The Vietnamese were regarded as silent workhorses. In the beginning, they were humble, quietly buying themselves irons, fans, and sewing machines. Controversy arises yet again while Soviet ballet was on its latest tour in the USA. Rudolf Nureyev, Natalia Makarova, Mikhail Baryshnikov were among those who had stayed behind in the past, and in 79, 30-year-old Bolshoi Theater dancer Alexander Garunov seeks political asylum. For 3 days, the Soviet plane with Garunov's wife Lyudmila Vlasova on board wasn't allowed to fly back to the USSR, with the Americans insisting that she make a decision concerning her own fate, with zero pressure on their behalf. Vlasova decided to return to the USSR. Garunov was the Bolshoi's lead dancer, and this was the first time they let him leave the country. While on tour, he left his hotel in New York and, after being granted asylum, attempted to contact his wife. A decision was made to send her back home. Garunov requested the State Department to intervene, claiming that his wife was being taken away forcibly. At the airport, it was obvious that Lyudmila was being escorted to the plane by a few well-built men. President Carter demanded to know whether Vlasova was leaving the United States by her own will. Police cars surrounded the Il-62 as it was preparing for takeoff. The Americans were allowed into the cabin twice, but they felt as if Vlasova was being threatened and demanded they meet on neutral territory. On day 3, a conversation took place on the airstrip, where Vlasova insisted that she wanted to go home, and so they let the plane fly to Moscow. The story with Vlasova was comprehensively covered by our papers, being labeled a disgusting provocative act. They also wrote that Garunov disappeared under unclear circumstances. In the spring of 1979, the UK general election ended with a decisive victory for the Conservative Party. This spelled the end for the Labour government, which Soviet people knew very little about, and marked the start of the age of Margaret Thatcher. Before the Iron Lady became the Prime Minister, she used to be depicted in caricatures published in Crocodile magazine as a predatory bird flying to a meeting of the far right. In several countries, Thatcher even replaced the Queen in the public's mind. She was also what the Soviet people imagined a true English lady should look like. Cold, arrogant, overbearing, wearing an impeccable British suit, sporting ideal hair, and a forced smile on her face. All of her famous doings were very much in line with age-old priorities of the United Kingdom. Thatcher was against integration with Europe, preferring the island to stay independent from the mainland. And in waging war with Argentina, she reminds all that Britain still dominates on the seas. In overcoming unions during an unprecedented coal miners' strike, she upheld classic capitalist principles. Our international affairs experts called this a Tories-controlled cabinet going against the people. The spectacular career of Margaret, the daughter of a grocery shop owner who became prime minister, is straight out of a Hollywood movie. That conservatism, which is inherent to all women by nature, in Margaret's case, it helped save the nation. She was able to prove the merits of classic capitalism, of efficient labor, a good education, personal success, and reverence for one's home and family. We saw plenty of recordings where her husband was preparing dinner, where you could see how nice and cozy of a house they had. She ironed her husband's trousers and got everyone to believe in her. I mean, all women who never had any interest in politics. Her unusual charisma had all the men basically worshipping her, everyone from politicians to regular unemployed blokes. Without identifying as a feminist, she was able to accomplish everything in proving that women are equal to men. Sherlock Holmes was the single most cinematized fictional character in the entire world. When declaring him as such, the Guinness Book of World Records found 187 Conan Doyle-based productions, where the famous detective from Baker Street had been played by 68 different actors. In 1979, this gentleman's club was joined by Vasily Livanov, who played the titular character in a TV series by Igor Maslennikov called The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson. with a clock ticking and firewood crackling in the background, this is how USSR's central television depicted the method of deduction. The characters were represented very much accurately. Alongside Vasily Livanov's Holmes, you had Vitaly Salamin's Watson, Borislav Brandukov as Inspector Lestrade, and Rina Zilyonaya playing Mrs. Hudson.
If you would have read my book on a detective's touch receptors, you'd have known that there are special heat points at the tips of your ears. So I do not have eyes on the back of my head. He saw your reflection in the coffee pot.
The show was a mild parody of Victorian-era England. Viewers appreciated exclamations such as "Porridge, sir," and "Elementary, my dear Watson."
"Elementary, my friend. It's a cocker spaniel."
"What is this, oatmeal?"
"Porridge, sir."
A polar expedition under the guise of Komsomolskaya Pravda makes it to the North Pole. 7 amateur explorers led by Steel and Alloy Institute Associate Professor Dmitry Shparo. In 1979, for the first time ever, humans made it to the North Pole on skis. Before that, the only way to make it was by dog sled, blimp, motorized sled, or airplane. Shparo's team covered 930 miles, while strictly abiding to their schedule. 50 minutes of travel, then 10 minutes of rest. For sleep, they'd pitch a tent right on top of the ice. Their main problem wasn't even minus 40 degree weather, but rather drift ice. These 7 brave men would constantly help each other out of the freezing water, which they'd fall into with all of their gear. Once he was on the Earth's axis, Shparo shot his rifle in a salute. Komsomolskaya Pravda suggested declaring the 31st of May, when that expedition made it to the pole, as International Men's Day. Let's talk nylon winter jackets with bright-colored liners and furry-edged hoods. They were developed by the Japanese based on Inuit's national clothing. All around the world, these were called anoraks. In our parts, though, they were called Alaskas, and worn from early autumn all the way to late spring. A simplified variant was made from raincoat fabric with a snap-on synthetic fur liner underneath. At first, they colored the thick exterior nylon olive, but then black and blue were added, while on the inside you had soft orange nylon. People would demonstrate the contrast while wearing these unbuttoned when walking from a restaurant to a cab. The snap-on fur jackets were much more modest and worn not by true ballers, but simply by well-dressed urbanites who thought demi-season trench coats to be obsolete.
Today, the last fruit fly perished.
Up until 1979, Iran was governed by Shah Mohammad Reza Pahlavi. He was on good terms with both Western powers and the Soviet Union. He'd visit us together with his gorgeous wife. Not a single agency in the world could have predicted the events which would ultimately be called the Islamic Revolution. The subordinates of a religious leader known as Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini disrupted the Shah's rule by means of spontaneous strikes and manifestations. The Shah mans the helm of his personal airplane and flees the country together with his family. 2 weeks after that, Khomeini returns from his exile in Paris. They say that he was greeted by approximately 10 million people. From then on, Iran was led by a mullah, who completely disregarded the preceding 1,000 years, eliminating monarchy, instating a republic, and getting rid of American oversight. In Khomeini's estimation, this is the political will of the Iranian people. According to Khomeini's teachings, foreigners had to be banished from the country. All power had to be handed over to religious figures. Also, you had to look to the Quran when making any sort of decision. People were allowed to only own what they earned by means of personal labor. Upon gaining power, Khomeini quickly disposes of his associates. He now had his own guard, the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps. Terrorist organizations in Muslim countries worshipped him as if he were a god. On November 4, 1979, armed fanatics stormed the U.S. Embassy in Tehran, taking almost 100 Americans as prisoners, while demanding the Shah be extradited and his assets turned over. The conditions for freeing all of the American citizens who are currently being held hostage in the embassy imply extraditing Iran's former Shah, who the people of Iran consider a criminal guilty of unlawfully acquiring the nation's resources and mass execution of regular Iranian citizens. In Moscow, the Islamic Revolution was dubbed anti-imperialist in the beginning, and then it hits us that instead of the Shah, who we used to build factories for in Isfahan, we were now dealing with an aggressive dictatorship run by Islamic fundamentalists, which was a bad example for the southern Soviet republics. Apparently, not everything that was detrimental to the USA was good for the USSR. Theatrical studios become a trend. There were a few dozen of these in the Republican capital cities, the largest provincial centers, not to mention Moscow and Leningrad. On one hand, studios were in opposition to the large-scale theaters, and on the other, they supplied them with talents and ideas. Acting technique was key, as in facial expressions, movements, and voice. Studios would experiment in basements, sometimes in youth palaces. The Ministry of Culture would bring foreign guests in to visit Tabakov, to show how liberal our studio movement is. Small kids in our country were aware of the woman who sings. The title of this 1979 film quickly became a household name. For Алла Пугачёва, this wasn't even a success, but rather an epic triumph. Everything about her creative work was controversial, but one thing nobody doubted. She was a superstar, not just on the stage, but in all regards. Russia was witnessing yet another Pugachev rebellion. Four years after her victory at Golden Orpheus, Pugachёva releases five big albums in the USSR and abroad, with two more on the way and another two being recorded. In the film, the lead bore the last name Strolcova. However, posters in Russian provinces bluntly stated that the movie was about Алла Пугачёва's difficult path to success. The Woman Who Sings was 1979's biggest box office hit. And according to a survey by Soviet Screen magazine, Pugachёva was Actress of the Year. A three-part TV series by director Georgi Jungwald Kilkevich called D'Artagnan and Three Musketeers gave birth to a new outdoor game, The King's Musketeers versus the Cardinal's Guard. A Lensovit theater actor named Mikhail Boyarsky became the latest sex symbol, a brown-haired guy with a mustache riding a horse who won fights and sang songs. In just a year, or immediately by Soviet standards, a two-piece album was released with songs that Maxim Dunayevsky wrote for this film. While staying in character, Boyarsky, dressed in all black, gave concerts where his gruff voice would be accompanied by a guitar and or by Dunayevsky playing a piano. Rumor had it that the musketeer was married to Pugachёva. Excuse me. Some unknown Georgian shopkeepers realized a super successful commercial undertaking in the field of Soviet consumer goods. They made plastic bags with two layers, and in between them, paper photo portraits by Valery Plotnikov. On one side you had red-headed Алла Пугачёва in a hoodie, and on the other Mikhail Boyarsky with a guitar, on a yacht sporting a super trendy combination of a black turtleneck under a blue shirt. Millions would go shopping for lightweight goods with these bags. Or, for example, take a towel to the beach in one. The 70s were a time of irregular warming of relations between the US and the Soviet Union. This culminated in an act of passionate friendship in 1979. Brezhnev kisses Carter in Vienna, where they arrived to sign some documents that in international political jargon would be labeled as SALT-2. For the first time, the superpowers agreed to limit their surplus of nuclear missiles. All three main components of strategic arms were subject to restriction. Launch pads for intercontinental ballistic missiles, submarine-launched ballistic missiles, and heavy bombers. A lavish meeting was arranged, with the ceremony taking place in the Hofburg, a Mozart performance at the Vienna Opera House, lunch in the Soviet embassy, the leaders making toasts for each other's health. That display in Vienna was the first and last kiss shared by CCCPSU General Secretary and President of the United States of America. Government agencies start using Yatran typewriters. Typing speed increases from 300 manual symbols per minute to 1,200 with electric drive. Typists now had it much easier, with them lightly touching the keys as opposed to hitting them. Being the main appliance in a multitude of Soviet agencies, the Yatran received a seal of quality. The very name Yatran sounded like chatter and a platen going back and forth. The hum of a working typewriter and its prolonged ratcheting were a common noise in offices, research institutes, HR departments, waiting rooms, and editorial offices. A new peak for emigration of Soviet Jews. Previously, during the 70s, a mere 30 to 35,000 a year would leave. In 1979, the number was 51,300. Plenty more people would stay and just change their last name and passport. It seemed as if Jews were disappearing from the USSR. HR departments and local KGB offices were identifying those who could receive an invitation from the other side of their lineage than where they got their last names from. These were the types that you didn't want working as assistant heads of departments. Writing Jew in an application form was more often considered as either defiance or a luxury afforded only by refuseniks, who had nothing to lose, or cultural icons who the nation wouldn't want to lose. In reality, Israel was the destination for those who weren't headed to the US. Israel already had an abundance of experts, which Vysotsky sang about to the tune of "Gynecologists are as common as stray dogs." In Israel, both boys and girls had to serve in an active army. This was a hot and very much developing country. Settling there was guaranteed rock bottom. The Soviet government wasn't really keeping track of who was going where, so the common conception was that the Jews were leaving for Israel. This is the Ben-Gurion Airport in Tel Aviv. By 1979, leaving for Israel was in itself a folklore theme. A Jewish wife wasn't a luxury, but a mode of transport. That's true. Suitcase, train station, Israel? Half true. Nobody really went by train. Flying instead. A quarter of the populace is our former compatriots. Not true at all, with Israel at the time being populated by only 5% Soviet Jews. Leonid Brezhnev bestows a Gold Star medal upon Todor Zhivkov. In 1979, the nation watches a five-part series by Stanislav Govoruchin based on a novel by the Weiner brothers called The Meeting Place Cannot Be Changed. This was a story from the life of Moscow's Criminal Investigation Department's anti-banditry unit, which employed Gleb Zheglov and Volodya Sharapov. Well, Saprykin? What have you gotten yourself into again?
Nothing. You stole her wallet.
He did.
A wallet, yeah? What wallet? Search me.
Go ahead, it's in his left pocket.
Don't move.
What?
Whose wallet is this? Instead of being obligated to uphold the law, these militia officers went by, a crook has to go to jail. We will put him away. You have my word. The angry investigator Zheglov, played by Vladimir Vysotsky, and Vladimir Konkin's mild-mannered investigator Sharapov. I just wanted to tell you. Excuse me for being so blunt. But your colleague Zheglov is a bad person. Don't get me wrong, it's not because he... It's just that to him people are garbage. Newspapers discuss meticulously obeying the law in the fight against those who violate it. As for the viewers, these charismatic personas didn't really allow them to see the theme of ends justifies the means. This became one of the most iconic pictures of that era, right up there next to White Son of the Desert. Oh, I'd really go for some hot soup with giblets. Grab me, Ivan! How do I do that? Gently! We suspect that you, good fellow, might be a snitch. Where's the hunchback? I said hunchback! In upholding a tradition established 11 years prior, in July near Куйбышев, yet another Grushinsky amateur song club festival is arranged. In 1979, a record amount of participants and spectators gather, bringing guitars, tents, and canned food. Specifically, over 100,000 people. In the entire country, there were over 100 ASCs, or amateur song clubs. This was the most popular informal movement. People would sing their own and others' songs. Some were rebellious, others full of soul. Performing for friends, that's what mattered. Here we see the closing performance for the festival, with viewers standing on the slope holding flashlights, and the prize winners on the guitar-shaped floating stage. A drop in the price of unreasonably expensive electronic wristwatches and pocket calculators, which were always overstocked, corresponded with yet another increase in the cost of exclusive prestige consumption items. Gold, rugs, fur all grew in price, that and furniture, also cars. For a while, certain gold products were readily available, since nobody was willing to trade their rubles for their truly universal counterpart. A new development involved ramping up prices in restaurants and cafes by some 25% to 45% in the evening, since the old prices created problems with available seating. Some spots were putting up signs saying no tables. People would buy jewelry, crystal glass, expensive furniture, pricey automobiles, not only to enjoy the beauty of it all, but also to project an image of belonging to a successful and a savvy group within the social hierarchy. In a socialist country, where everything revolves around distributing scarce goods, that which you can find on a store shelf, by definition cannot be considered a status consumption item. If anybody can buy it, it's for losers, for those who don't belong at the proper table. And that's why the biggest problems with selling luxury goods always came up when, after yet another increase in prices, for whatever reason, some kind of product accidentally turned out to be in stock in stores. Demand would rapidly plummet. I mean, who'd want to be perceived as a sucker by everybody around them? In 1979, the Ministry of Culture secured Englishman Elton John and Frenchman Joe Dassin for a few concerts, which would become the last given by Western pop music stars in a stable USSR. Elton John performed in Moscow and Leningrad, where he didn't dance on top of a piano like he would in Europe, but still looked extravagant in his pink trousers, striped hat, on a stage with smoke and projectors. To us, all of this was foreign glamour. Joe Dassin agreed to do only one performance, at the Cosmos Hotel opening ceremony. He wasn't exactly the brightest shining star in Paris, but he was the most popular traditional Western stage singer in the USSR at the time. The Cosmos Hotel was Moscow's lucky horseshoe. It was built with the upcoming Olympics in mind. Management had 1 year to bring customer service up to international standards. This was actually the first time a hotel was ever built in the USSR under the assumption that they would be observed. By 1979 standards, Cosmos was a true four-star hotel. 3 years ago at Mira Avenue in Moscow began the construction of the Cosmos Hotel, the result of collaboration between Soviet and French architects. The Interest Association's new flagship hotel had a capacity of 3,500 guests. At Cosmos, you had 6 restaurants, 5 bars, a swimming pool with an artificial beach. But nobody knew that aside from foreign guests. Soviet citizens were left to be astonished by its innovative architecture. Soon this amazing hotel will accommodate those participating in the Summer Spartakiad of the peoples of the USSR. During the 1980 Olympics, it'll be occupied by radio and TV media crews. Central Committee member, Foreign Affairs Minister Raoul Leroy and other officials. In 1979, a 12th copy run of a literature almanac called Metropole is released. 1,000 plus pages of rejected essays, prose, and poetry glued to some Wattman paper by hand. This sparked the most hectic controversy in the world of Soviet self-publishing. Metropole can be read as Metropolitan Literary Process. Contributors to the almanac included Aksionov, Bitov, Vysotsky, Akhmadulina, and Iskander. They were seriously planning on offering Metropole for publication in the USSR and abroad, with a foreword saying, "No attachments or censorship allowed." A presentation was being prepared in a cafe in Moscow, but the KGB surrounded the area, and an investigation ensued at the Writers' Union. Young Viktor Yerofeyev and Yevgeny Popov were expelled. This encouraged the New York Times to stand in a protest. Vonnegut, Styron, Miller, Olby, Updike, they threatened to ban publishing their work in the USSR. The American classics were addressed by the literary newspaper. This is how the masses learned about Metropole. Ultimately, it was published in the West. None of those involved were prosecuted, but publishing books in the USSR became difficult for them, if not impossible. For 45 years, a Central American country called Nicaragua was being run by dictators from the Somoza dynasty. When Roosevelt uttered his famous, "He's a son of a bitch, but he's our son of a bitch," he was referring to a leader of Nicaragua. By 1979, the latest in a line of Somozas went so far off the rails that even the Americans wanted nothing to do with him. Nicaragua entered the Sandinista Revolution. Sandino was the president general who was overthrown by the first Somoza. The Sandinista National Liberation Front occupied most of the country. Somoza retaliated by randomly bombing rebel-controlled cities. Once the rebels surrounded the capital city of Managua, Somoza resigned and fled to Florida, where his family was living. The country was now run by Sandinista front leadership under Daniel Ortega. Cuba sends aid in the form of produce and medicine. The Sandinistas sentenced Somoza to death in his absence, and the following year they acted on it by executing the former dictator in Paraguay. Fartsovka, or the illegal sale of foreign goods, was going on in every city. There were massive amounts of black marketers who would formerly be working as superintendents somewhere. Unlike, for example, currency traders, everybody was aware of these illegal merchants, who were often written about in the papers. They typically sell radio equipment, records, perfume, but the hottest item was, of course, jeans. Each big city had at least a few go-to spots where you could buy yourself a pair of jeans. There would be unsuccessful militia crackdowns from time to time, but apparently the cops were in on it, as suggested by the more discerning folks. In Leningrad, the main spot for illegal trade was the Galyura Shopping Gallery. In Moscow, the main hub in all of the USSR was located at Begovaya metro station. Sellers would find customers next to the local thrift store, behind the gas stations where you'd try the jeans on, and you'd pay for them next to the subway entrance. Dividing the trade into stages makes it more difficult to catch someone red-handed and prove the fact of reselling with the intent of extracting a profit. Merchants would wear the same clothing that they sold, so they did stand out in their short jackets with upright fur collars, jeans, and pointy shoes on elevated oblique heels. On August 11, 1979, at an altitude of over 27,500 feet over Dnepro-Dzerzhinsk, two commercial Tu-134A airliners collide. One of those planes was taking the coaches and players of a Tashkent-based soccer team called Paktakor to a USSR championship match in Minsk. Plane crashes usually didn't make it into the news, but hiding this one was impossible. Thousands of Tashkent residents came to the funeral. Despite losing its entire main lineup at once, Paktakor continued to participate in the championship, aided by players from other teams. The USSR Sports Committee issued a decree to keep Paktakor in the Supreme League for three more years, regardless of their results. In 1979, English rock band Pink Floyd released an album called The Wall, which swiftly made it to our parts. Thanks to the voices and tape recordings, Pink Floyd had a long-standing reputation of being the most intellectual foreign rock band. VCRs were extremely rare in the Soviet Union, so there was basically nobody to admire the epic lighting and visual effects of the music video, but these long compositions were impressive to listen to as well. Komsomolskaya Pravda described the album using the words, "a bitter song about a wall that stands between the elites and common folk in the West." Later, because of a verse from their anti-war album, Brezhnev took Afghanistan, Begin took Beirut, Pink Floyd wound up blacklisted as one of the anti-Soviet rock bands. While the hunters were loading their rifles, the final 30th volume of the third red edition of the Great Soviet Encyclopedia is published. With 630,000 copies printed, this was the most mass-produced reference guide in the world. 100,000 articles written by 10,000 scientists, this was indeed a great encyclopedia. And it truly was Soviet. It was claimed to be compiled based on a class and party approach, with Communist Party affiliation corresponding to scientific grounds. Colorful and energetic theatrical directing captivates TV viewers. Mark Zakharov, who ran the Lenkom Theater in Moscow, made a TV adaptation of a play by Yevgeny Schwartz called An Ordinary Miracle. Everything on screen was lit, singing and moving around. So are you coming?
Not a chance. I'll tell my husband, and he'll transform you into a rat.
Who's the husband?
He's a magician.
You need to warn about these things.
As is fitting for a fairy tale's protagonist, Alexander Abdulov becomes a celebrity overnight. That was something for the female fans, while the men were treated to political satire with an edgy subtext. Here's the king played by Yevgeny Leonov.
As an honorary saint? An honorary martyr? Honorary Roman Pope? Of our kingdom? Let us begin the ritual.
The grown-ups, whose childish innocence was long gone, admired such cheeky fairy tales. Intriguing historical prose was booming. Readers, and usually these were all the same type of reader, were really into two very different authors from two distinct literary factions. Bulat Okudzhava wrote romantic historical novels, while Valentin Pikul did historical adventure novels. The country began to read Okudzhava's Travel of Amateurs, which was published in 1978, and in the spring of 79, Pickle releases his most controversial novel called At the Last Frontier. A famous bard and a darling of the intellectuals, Okudzhava embarked on a light trip across the previous century. Poor Abrosimov, Merci or the Adventures of Shipov, Date with Bonaparte, these books featured gallant characters and an ironic and lyrical writing style. Pickle's titles were somewhat more intense. The Battle of Iron Chancellors, By Plume and Sword, Word and Deed. In his latest novel, Pickle described Rasputin in a rather juicy way. While emphasizing the disruptive influence of St. Petersburg-based Jewish bankers in the Russian turmoil of 1917, the propaganda department reacted quite nervously, with Pickle being berated for vulgarizing history. The whole year we were getting strange news from Afghanistan, the USSR's southernmost neighbor. Nobody really paid attention to them up until a point. During the previous 1978, the April Revolution triumphed in Afghanistan. A revolutionary council was now running the country, with Nur Mohammad Taraki at the helm. Fast forward to spring of 79, and a skirmish occurs in Herat. Come autumn, and Taraki resigns due to illness, replaced by Hafizullah Amin. Within a month, Taraki is declared dead. But in reality, a civil war had been raging in Afghanistan since the summer. Taraki contacted Soviet leadership a number of times, requesting direct military intervention, and he was denied every time. And finally, in December, it was announced that the Soviet Union would provide military aid to Afghanistan, meaning we were sending in our troops. During the final week of the heated December of 79, a reconnaissance battalion crossed the border, and the 103rd Guards Airborne Division deployed at the Kabul airport. The Soviet ambassador informed Hafizullah Amin about the situation. One day later, there was an attempt to poison Amin at lunch, but to no avail. So in the evening, the Alpha Group stormed the presidential palace and assassinated Amin. Babrak Karmal became the new head of state. He was Afghanistan's ambassador in Czechoslovakia. Amin's death was presented as him being sentenced to capital punishment by revolutionary court for crimes against his people. Brezhnev congratulates Karmal with his new position. I studied the history of the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, and I can rather confidently assess the reasons for why it happened. The aging Soviet leaders made a strategic mistake that was bordering on senile. They decided that the Soviet Union, which at the moment in terms of its strategic and military capabilities was as potent a force as it ever had been, was completely surrounded and needed to defend itself. They looked towards the east and saw that the United States Secretary of Defense was in talks about a possible strategic coalition with China. They put out a false rumor about a possible union between China, Japan, and the United States in the Far East. America's Navy was already present in the Persian Gulf, though it didn't pose any threat to the Soviet Union. NATO was about to implement a re-equipment program. Then they started deploying Pershing II missile systems. The Politburo decided to draw a line in the sand. A decision was made to send troops to Afghanistan in support of a seemingly pro-Soviet regime. The Soviet communist leadership apparently wasn't well-versed in history. Otherwise, they would have remembered that plenty of great armies perished in the mountains of Afghanistan, from Alexander the Great to British conquerors. Soviet military leaders knew what it was like to fight in Afghanistan, and they knew the history of war. That's why, from what we know, General Staff Chief Ogarkov and his deputy Akhromeyev objected to the whole thing, but nobody was listening to them. Political workers explained to soldiers that we barely beat the Pakistanis to enter Afghanistan, that Amin was a pawn of the CIA, that China set its sights on Afghanistan. US-Chinese collusion against Afghanistan was a commonly used one from then on. Meanwhile, all the population got was a comment by TASS and a message saying that the Afghani revolution had entered a new phase. And though aside from military consultants, they used to send a lot of tech experts to these parts as well, by 1979, we basically knew nothing about Afghanistan. The news on our troops entering the country wasn't really a shock, but the word war didn't really enter anybody's mind. Our troops were present in most socialist countries anyway, no big deal. And that's actually where many people would strive to do service. When sending troops to Afghanistan, the government wasn't doing much to clarify the matter, leaving it at a few vague phrases about stabilizing the situation in a friendly neighboring nation. The fact that our propaganda machine initially ignored the matter resulted in nobody asking any questions. The people assumed that there has to be some kind of temporary need to cross the border, and that our troops would be out of there in no time. Some of those who initiated the invasion had similar reasoning. Also, let's not forget that the Soviet people were preparing for New Year. And during those final 3 days of 1979, starting from the 28th, when TASS issued its historic message, nobody really understood what exactly was brewing in Afghanistan. ''1979 was the year when karate became legal in the USSR. After a 10-year ban, all union federations were established. The first tournaments were staged, though only the non-contact form was accepted, when opponents would no more than signify their blows. This new martial art attracted plenty of attention. Karate schools were opening all around the country, and the previous favorites, sambo and judo, suddenly looked old-fashioned. Karate schools were difficult to regulate, with them being so plentiful, and new ones were sprouting out of nowhere, since they operated under the principle of self-sustainability. But very soon they put the free-for-all in check, and only the schools working under society's CSK and Dynamo were left. The others went underground, and earned their very own article of the criminal code, 219 Prim, illegally teaching karate. With his uncommon by pop music standards deep voice, singing songs about Signorita Pompadora and Italiano Bella, as well as roles in comedy films titled The Con Artists and The Taming of the Scoundrel, an Italian man named Adriano Celentano became the main foreign sex symbol of the turn of that decade. Love-stricken women describe guys like Celentano using words such as my outlaw. Jokes made by the aggressive protagonist were watered down in translation.
Pero, my boy! What an encounter! So they released you from the leper colony? Apparently so!
This manliest of men sparked an Italian pop music fashion trend. These had to be the most popular foreign melodies of the 1980s.
What the... No! A million in cash. Oh, God. Why did we deserve this?
And that was 1979 in our show the other day, 1961 to 1991, current era. Events, people, and occurrences which defined a lifestyle. Next episode will be about 1980. Sheremetyevo II, Sakharov's deportation, sheepskin coats, the Moscow Olympics, Vysotsky's death, Lenin's murder, Junam, Iran and Iraq go to war, Baltic pop music. See you for another episode and another year. Farewell.